In this video, we're analyzing a general vertical Atwood machine. And what I mean by general is just that the masses are given symbolically as M1 and M2 instead of being given actual numbers for those. And we have two main goals for the problem. We want to find the acceleration of this Atwood machine and the tension in the string after it's released from rest. We're using two common approximations here. The first is that the string is very light, and the second is that the pulley is very light. This means we don't have to worry about the weight of the string itself, and we don't have to worry about the inertia of the pulley. And what this all amounts to is the fact that the tension exerted by that string is going to be exactly the same at each end. So the first thing we need to do is create complete force diagrams for these masses. And we're going to start things out by putting the force of gravity in. So I put the two weight vectors in, pointing down, of course, and their magnitudes are computed as M1g and M2g, respectively. And notice in the picture that M1 was drawn bigger than M2. So we're just going to assume, for all the qualitative setup of the problem, that M1 is actually bigger than M2. And this tells us which way the system is going to accelerate. Now, if you plug numbers in and M1 is actually smaller than M2, all the formulas still work. But we have to assume a specific direction of motion here as we're setting up the qualitative things in our diagram and setting up our equations. So notice that I drew the weight vector longer for M1 based on the assumption that it's actually the bigger mass. The next thing we do is get the tension into the diagram. And again, the tension will be the same at each end of that string as long as it's a light string and the pulley is light as well. Notice what I did with the relative magnitude of the tension and those two weights. Because I know M1 is going to accelerate downward, that means the weight of M1 should exceed the tension that's pulling in the opposite direction. That gives me a net force pointed downward, so an acceleration going downward. So I did draw M1g a bit longer than T. At the same time, T should be a little bit bigger than M2g to create a net upward force on M2, the smaller mass. Now, it's going to be important to be clear about which direction is treated as positive for the analysis of each of these masses. And the standard way to do this is just to say the actual direction of acceleration, that's going to be positive. So there's the acceleration vectors for each of these masses. And what we're going to do is call downward positive for the analysis of M1 and upward positive for the analysis of M2. And so this means if M1 is actually bigger than M2, that A is going to be a positive number in each of those equations. But everything still works out even if M1 is smaller than M2. It just means the actual acceleration is going the opposite direction, and we would get a negative number for each of those accelerations. So what you don't want to do is accidentally analyze it so that positive is the upward direction for each mass, because those two masses are accelerating in opposite directions. One is up and one is down. And so one of those A's will represent a positive number and one will represent a negative number. And that blows up the algebra when we set up our equations. So again, the best practice is to just draw an actual direction of acceleration and call that positive for the analysis of each mass. So now we just apply Newton's second law to each moving piece of the system. So we'll just start with M1. And we want to write down that Fnet equals MA. Again, we're using downward as positive for this mass because we're imagining that that's the heavier mass and it's accelerating downward. So to write down the net force, I have a positive M1g and a negative T. And that's equal to the mass M1 times the acceleration. Next, we analyze M2. And for M2, remember, we're imagining that it accelerates upward. So we count upward as positive, and T is our positive term here. T minus M2g, that's the net force. That's equal to the mass M2 times the acceleration A. And so we're looking at a system of two equations and two unknowns, where the unknowns are tension and acceleration. And you should notice that these are already set up for a quick elimination of one of the variables. If I add these two equations, the T's are going to cancel. So on the left side, I get M1g minus M2g. And on the right side, I get M1a plus M2a. And the point here is to solve for the unknown acceleration. So on the right-hand side, I could factor an a out of that and write it as a times the quantity M1 plus M2. The left side could also be factored. I could write that as M1 minus M2, all multiplying g. So now we can solve for our acceleration. And this result has a really nice symmetry to it. We can write it as M1 minus M2 divided by M1 plus M2 times g. Notice that the units are going to work out nicely here, because those mass units cancel in that fraction. So the units on the right-hand side of this equation are the same as the units of g, which is units of acceleration. All right, now one of the cool things that we can do when we're solving a problem in a totally general way like this is we can come up with some different tests to really see if we're confident in this solution, like does it make sense? So we just look at some special cases where we know physically what should happen and make sure the formula is behaving correctly. So the first thing I want to do is test what happens when M1 is equal to M2. What do we expect to happen physically? If M1 is equal to M2, the Atwood machine is balanced, the acceleration should be zero. If I look at my acceleration formula, it has an M1 minus M2 right in the numerator. So if M1 is equal to M2, A is equal to zero. All right, so that's good. We're starting to have more confidence in our formula. There's a couple more things we could check out with our formula. For example, if M1 is bigger than M2, then the way we defined our acceleration, A should be positive. And again, if we look in the formula for A, it has an M1 minus M2 in the numerator, which means if M1 is bigger than M2, A is positive. So that's working out correctly. It works the other way around. If M1 was less than M2, that would create a negative acceleration. Physically, what would happen there is that everything would be accelerating in the opposite direction from how we defined it in the diagram, and that would result in a negative A. So that checks out. And then the final thing I want to do is imagine if M1 was way bigger than M2. And again, I mean way bigger. So I'm imagining like M1 is a bowling ball and M2 is a feather. What happens in that case is that the acceleration should be approaching free fall. It should be the same as G itself. So if I look in our formula for the acceleration and imagine that M1 is way bigger than M2, then in the numerator, M2 is negligible, and that reduces to just M1. In the denominator, M2 is negligible, and that reduces to M1. And then we have this G tacked on. Well, M1 divided by itself is just 1, and I find that my acceleration is equal to G. So with all these things working correctly in our formula, we're starting to have a lot of confidence that we've done things correctly. Okay, so what about the tension in the string? Now that we have the acceleration, we can just go back to either one of these original equations that we set up using Newton's second law and solve for T. And just to avoid an extra minus sign, it looks like the second equation is the easiest one to work with. So I'm going to solve that for T real quick and write T is M2G plus M2A. It's probably a good idea to go ahead and factor this. So I'm going to write it as M2 times G plus A. And now we just have to plug in the acceleration that we already found. So we have this big fraction for the acceleration, m1 minus m2 divided by m1 plus m2 times g. And of course, we can pull a g out of that. So now I have an m2g times 1 plus m1 minus m2 over m1 plus m2. And we're going to clean this up. So we need to get a common denominator here. And we get that done by multiplying this 1 by m1 plus 2 over itself. So we have, instead of a 1, we have an m1 plus m2 divided by itself. And then our original fraction over here, m1 minus m2 over m1 plus m2. Now we can go ahead and add the numerators of these two fractions, but I notice I have an m2 and a negative m2, so those cancel out. And then I have an m1 plus another m1, that gives me 2m1. So I have m2g times 2m1 over m1 plus m2. And just cleaning it up a little bit more, we can write the tension as 2m1m2g divided by m1 plus m2. Now I can think of one test to figure out whether or not this formula makes sense. I can imagine, what if m1 and m2 are actually equal? Well, if these two masses are equal, there's not going to be any acceleration to the system. And that means the tension pulling up on each mass would just be equal to its weight. So the tension should come out to just mg. If both of these masses were equal and we give them a value of m. So thinking about that case, where m1 is equal to m2 and I just call them both m, plugging into this formula, I would get 2m times m, or 2m squared, g, over m plus m, which is 2m. The 2s cancel, one of the m's cancels, and I get a tension of mg, like I should if the Atwood machine is balanced. So that's it for the solution of the general vertical Atwood machine. Now that we have these formulas, we could just plug in whatever mass numbers we want, and the correct acceleration and tension will pop out immediately. Notice again that if we put in an M1 that's smaller than M2, A just comes out negative. If it's more like what it looks in the picture, where M1 is bigger than M2, A comes out positive. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.